Penguin Random House Audio presents, directed by James Burrows. 5 decades of stories from the legendary director of Taxi, Cheers, Frasier, Friends, Will and Grace, and more. By James Burrows, with Eddie Friedfeld. Read for you by James Burrows. Foreword by Glenn and Les Charles. Read by Danny Campbell.
This is dedicated to the one I love, to every one of you who has grown up with sitcoms and shared both laughter and tears with family and friends. This place is the closest thing I have to a real home. Sam Malone, Cheers.
Foreword. Glenn and Les Charles. Our first encounter with James Burrows was in the 1970s on a soundstage at MTM Enterprises, where we'd gotten our first staff writing position, i.e., full-time job. We'd gone to the stage to see a run-through of the week's show being directed by a newcomer, a young man, bearded and bald beyond his years. He was in the process of getting his butt chewed out by one of our show's executive producers, who was never the least bit shy about sharing his opinions loudly and publicly. The young director stood there taking it, but not liking it. We decided it was pointless to introduce ourselves to the poor bastard, because he was clearly going to be on the next plane back to wherever he'd made the mistake of leaving. If anyone had told us we'd one day partner with him in what would turn out to be the most happily successful show and production company in our careers, we'd have thought them insane. Of course, you've guessed by now that poor bastard is the author and subject of this book. Jimmy Burrows weathered that storm and went on to become a great friend and a brilliant and incomparably successful director. He was just starting out in his profession that day, but it seemed like he'd been destined for a career in show business for his entire life. Born to legendary writer, humorist, script doctor, and personality Abe Burrows, he'd spent hours of his life in theaters and studios and socialized with people whose names the average person only sees on a marquee. It was as if both nature and nurture intended that he become a member of the entertainment world. But what was he to do? He couldn't act his way out of the rain, couldn't write, sing, dance, or play an instrument with any distinctive ability. He tried to yodel, do impressions anyone recognized, throw his voice, juggle plates, or saw a woman in half. Volunteers for rehearsal are tough to enlist. Then inspiration struck. Directing was the perfect job. He could do it sitting down. He could wear any clothes he wanted, and he could tell everyone what to do. And if anything ever went wrong, he could blame it on the writers. Whatever the real origin of his career choice might have been, it has entertained millions, starting with the brothers Charles. We worked together with him on many MTM shows, then for 4 years on Taxi. Our collaboration over those years was so positive, we ultimately decided to make it legal. We made some very good and some very lucky decisions together over the years, but the best one was the first. We became partners. It seemed inevitable. We'd grown up together, worked out any personality kinks, and had the important things in common. We admired the same movies and TV shows. We laughed at the same things, and most important, we liked each other. As only people who have shared hundreds of meals eating from styrofoam containers on their laps can bond. As excited as we were to be working with Jimmy at the time, even we, his biggest fans, couldn't have predicted how far he would go. He's simply become the greatest director of comedy in television history. And that's not just the opinion of Jimmy and his wife, though they're the only ones who have it on their bath towels. He's the greatest by any measurement. Number of episodes, number of gigantic hit series, number of awards, and the amount and volume of laughter he's been responsible for. And, amazingly, when he's not working on a series, he's doing pilots for new series. We could write a book ourselves about everything that Jimmy brings to his work. He's smart and incredibly inventive. He's in full control on stage. There's never a doubt who's in charge. Yet, within the order he maintains, he makes space for people to feel comfortable to experiment and create. He's an actor's director, as any actor who's worked with him will tell you, but he's also a writer's director. Maybe in part because of his father, he understands how writing works and why it sometimes doesn't. Most important, he knows good writing when he sees it. First and foremost, he has the perfect temperament for the job. He's particularly well-suited for directing TV, where, as opposed to film and theater, casts and crews can sometimes work together for years, as has been the case for Jimmy several times. The situation requires a special kind of personality, pretty much exactly the one he has. We've never seen him lose his temper, though we have seen him want to. He has no capital E ego. He's supernaturally patient, calm when everyone around him is pounding on panic buttons. And he's a great audience and encourager. People want to do their best for him. They want to make him laugh. And oh yeah, Jimmy's funny. One day when we were just starting to put Cheers together, the three of us were in our office and were presented with a huge stack of legal documents for our signatures. They were detailed partnership contracts, anticipating every possible contingency and laying out legal procedures to settle any future disputes. We stared glumly at them in silence for a moment. Then Jimmy said, "I'm okay with a handshake." We shook hands and tossed all the paper in the trash. That was over 40 years ago, and working with him has never been anything but a pleasure and an honor. And a hell of a lot of fun. Ready when you are, JB.
Prologue. I agonize over laughter, more specifically getting the best, smartest character-driven laughs. I also wrestle with character. Is the character likable, believable, and sustainable? When I direct a television show, I try to reach that sweet spot where the best script meets the best performance and the best chemistry between performers. Hitting that exact moment where these factors land in combination results in the sweetest and most enduring laugh. Part of that means figuring out why something isn't working and how to give the actors and writers input, suggestions, and guidance as to how to make it work. The process is like sculpting clay. It must be formed carefully and passionately. Whether working on an entire series, one episode, or just one scene, a director must be thinking about how to develop characters and have them interact with other characters who are also growing. That's what creates good comedy. The sitcom has been a staple in American homes since the 1930s golden age of radio. Over the decades, there have been extremely creative shows that were ahead of their time. Sitcoms are families that we introduce first to the American audiences and then to viewers all over the world. They are the friends and families we choose that helps us connect with our own families. They are often unlikely friendships and always different circumstances at hand. But the shows are invariably about people who form a common and inextricable bond. Taxi featured a family of unrelated people trying to get out of a dead-end joint and into a better life. Cheers was a family of people that met regularly at a bar where they could share their stories. Friends was a form family trying to help one another navigate young adulthood. Will and Grace was about people getting to choose, a family that gave them acceptance and encouragement, protecting and supporting one another against a world that was at least in part prejudiced against them. With all those different bents and permutations, it is always basically about a family, and over time, they become our family. I have spent most of my professional life developing and directing a certain type of comedy, the situation comedy, the sitcom. Sitcom directors are in charge of the set, establish the tone and pace of the show, and elicit the performances. They ultimately communicate the vision of the writers and actors, which starts with the ideas on the empty page and ends with people at home watching and laughing. If you ask most people to tell you what their five favorite television shows are, odds are that a few of them will be sitcoms. The same goes with favorite characters. And if you ask someone about their favorite sitcom, they will likely not only talk about the characters and the comedy, but also about where they were in their lives when they watched it and with whom they watched it, about who introduced them to the sitcom and to whom they introduced the sitcom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.